Wiping your mouth is so mundane, but to invent a self-operating napkin, that is by far more interesting in the mind's eye of Rube Goldberg. This is just one of many illustrated contraptions, affectionately known as a Rube Goldberg machine. We celebrate the artist, cartoonist, inventor, his satire, and lasting cultural impact. This is Rube Goldberg, a lot of moving pieces on Newsmakers.
Growing up, the term that's a Rube Goldberg, would simply mean you took the long way around to solve the problem, and which may or may not have been solved. But in doing so, that process was always a humorous one. You know, I think he's one of the few, if not the only American, that's name became an adjective.
Found within the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, Rube Goldberg is defined as accomplishing by complex means what seemingly could be done simply. The term's first known use was in 1928. At this stage in his career, Goldberg was a 45-year-old celebrity.
Well, folks, there she is, the Rube Goldberg door opener upper. Sure, I know they have a gadget called an electric eye that does practically the same thing, but that's no good for a waiter. You see, the electricity might give the waiter a shock, then he'd forget to come back to pick up his tip, and he'd lose his professional standing. How does this door opener upper really work? It's very simple, but watch close. Now here's what happens. You see, waiter places cat B on pile of dirty dishes A. Now cat B sees mouse C.
What is it about the Rube Goldberg machine that people can associate with, and why was it so embraced?
In sort of the male character, a desire to tinker and to try to do something. And I think there's maybe even a cliche-ish American idea that we can do it. We don't need anyone's help, we can figure it out. And again, timing is everything. So this is a time where American industry is expanding, immigration is expanding, there is greater diversity, there's all sorts of different influences that are coming into America and making it an interesting and diverse place. But there is that belief that if you can do it, if you work hard enough, you can make something, you can do something. So I think that American ingenuity concept, contraptions captured that sense. And I wasn't alive back then, so I don't really know, but that's what I would assume. And also I think there's something about humor and the ridiculousness of it. And even some of those contraptions today, some of the early ones are a little bit lost on, because we don't even have some of those tools anymore. Yes. I mean, they become kind of archaic.
Which ignites fuse F and sets off bomb G, opening door H very gently. Well, folks, I suppose there are one or two among you who think that my inventions are a bit ahead of their time. A shade fantastic, perhaps. All right, go on and say it. Downright screwy.
America's fascination with machines and Goldberg's contraptions seep into popular culture. Comedic actor and filmmaker Charlie Chaplin adapts the nation's embrace of a contemporary society in the 1936 classic Modern Times. Reuben Garrett Lucius Goldberg was born July 4, 1883, to German-Jewish immigrants Max and Hannah Goldberg. He was the second of four children, a creative child with a passion for drawing.
His beginnings start where?
in San Francisco. His father was the sheriff of San Francisco. It seems that he was always drawing and went to Berkeley, University of California, Berkeley, got his degree in engineering, mining engineering, but always had a love for art, for drawing. And his father, like many families, myself an artist, so I know that that's not the career necessarily parents want you to go into, mainly because it's very hard to sustain. He worked for about 6 months with the sewer company in San Francisco and talked to his father, who they were very close, and had an opportunity to take a pay cut to do some cartooning, some drawing for the paper. And that was sort of the beginning.
In 1904, Goldberg was hired by the San Francisco Chronicle as a sports cartoonist. Shortly after, he made the leap to the East Coast.
As he developed, he decided he needed to get to New York and came to New York in 1907, which is an amazing time to be in New York. There was a market crash. We lost about 50% of the market value, which was kind of frightening. But the other part was, this is a time where the Industrial Revolution was coming into full swing. Everything was happening culturally, economically. It was an amazing time, and he was a person who was a great observer and could take that those observations and put them to paper.
This is a time when we're transitioning from horse and buggy to automobile.
Yeah.
And so his illustrations, his cartooning, his engineering background, and we see him develop the inventions put to paper. Was he helping Americans cope with this transition?
Well, I think that there was a lot of other things going on as well. Certainly there was a love affair of the machine, and which kind of hits a wall after the First World War. And in the world of art, you have the rise of Dada, which is sort of anti-art. Then there's this love of machine, and then the machine being not so lovable. And I think all of these things were in the air. I can't imagine another period of time as exciting as the period of time that Rube Goldberg was in New York. My target was really about the drawings and putting him in a different context, a historical context, not only in the world of art, but also in American context of humorists like Mark Twain and Will Rogers, or regionalist painters like Thomas Hart Benton and Grant Wood. So, you know, you can see, and even the way the characters are rendered is a very strong relationship.
What fascinates you the most as you've explored the life and the works of Rube Goldberg?
His hand. I think his drawings are amazing. I especially am taken by the drawings from the late 19-teens, say 1910 to the 1930s. I think those are amazing small works of art, and their relationship to the history of art is very strong. Who does this figure remind you of?
That figure reminds me of, and I'm young, well, I'm old enough. I wish I were young enough. I'm old enough to remember that character looks a lot like olive oil from Popeye.
And I think this drawing is a few years before Popeye strip comes out. But what I also want you to see is how he sets up the composition and the way he uses pattern to move the eye, the viewer's eye, around the drawing, and how that oscillation not only creates the depth, but it also mimics what's happening with the machine. What is interesting, I think, about Rube Goldberg's work is the articulation of his line and his pattern and his use of pattern to move the viewer through the figures and what's happening. And he also, not everybody's face gets seen. So You have this figure to the back. You see her face. This face is to a side. She has a much more naturalistic look than the olive oil character, who looks very much like a cartoon. So there's these kind of interplays that are fascinating, and I think bring in a lot more investigation for the viewer.
These are cartoons, they're illustrations. What, in your mind, what is the style that we see?
If you look at the broader picture of cartooning and animation that was going on at that period, there's strong relationships. There's an articulation of his line that really puts him in, a special category beyond the cartoonist of the era. I think they're like small finished drawings that have a strong relationship to Netherlandish work from the Middle Ages. The figures are very realized. There's a sense of weight and volume in the works. In fact, in a lot of cases, the strips are like small predella panels. He's able to create the depth, unlike in the previous drawing, through a linear perspective. He's doing it through atmospheric perspective. You can see the figures as they move further back in space, being less able to be seen. As a child, I was a cartoonist and became an artist, and I was always fascinated with the way the contraptions were made in his drawing and the articulated line. But I wasn't as well, I didn't really know about his cartoons as much until I got involved with this project. And that changed everything.
There's a certain, and you tell me if I'm wrong, like a certain childlike quality with Rube Goldberg. Once you cartoon, I think that just sticks with you.
Yeah, I agree. I think that you're looking at the work of a gentleman who was not formally trained, who maybe had a couple of years of working, having some lessons by a sign painter in San Francisco. But he was left-handed. He drew with his right, but he developed all this through observation. And the amount of work that he did is staggering. To your point about cartooning and humor, I think that you maintain a childlike quality. Otherwise, you don't see the world through those lenses.
So this reality that is in everybody's face, he's using satire to make people feel better.
He's using satire and parody. He's making some comments about foolishness, which we all participate in, and he's also, you look at some of the characters in the cartoons and the drawings. You can still see these figures in New York. You walk down the street, go anywhere, and what's beautiful about his drawings is these personalities that he draws, these kind of caricatures, actually become that type of stereotype person. The cartoon is about ladies' fashion, this particular situation about skirts. And you have the two ladies that are represented here, that are rendered in a more naturalistic way, almost as if you were drawing a person. However, the group of men are all cartoonish and kind of goofy, and don't look like they are part of the actual scene. They look like they're part of a cartoon. And everything else is put into place. Cityscape is rendered in a very naturalistic way. It is kind of a stage set, but it gives us a place for which we can view the setting.
And this guy says she's a peach.
So these are all people that everyone can associate with. They know this person in their life.
I would think so. And I mean, certainly the other side to that, we were just talking earlier today, the other part is that there are some things that are lost to us today, the vernacular of the time. Certain comments or conversations or viewpoints that would have been acceptable or been in commonplace in the late teens and early 20s of the previous century. That's not us today. So it's like it's going back into history.
Connecting with his growing national audience, Goldberg popularizes New York City street slang, terms he helped to make commonplace, like baloney and phony baloney, Lollapalooza and you can have it, just to name a few. In 1916, Goldberg married Irma Seaman. The couple had two sons, Thomas and George. Here in this rare family film, Rube spends time at his drafting table with his boys.
I see him just being sort of an every guy. He's an observer. He's the person who is watching everything and recording it. He's also takes about 1910 to 1915, he's doing some vaudeville. So you can see the influence of vaudeville in his work and the way the viewer is seen, how the narrative goes from stage to stage to stage. And within the boxes, how characters move in and out of stage, basically.
What do you have?
Goldberg's knack for cartoon performance was elevated to new heights when he wrote the Three Stooges screenplay, Soup to Nuts, in 1930.
There's only one banana left, and it's too old to do the splits. All right, give me some bicarbonate of soda. Now that makes me hungry. I'll have a bowl of soup with some nuts in it.
He's also good friends with Groucho Marx. He's a frequent guest at the Algonquin Roundtable. The Gershwin brothers are guests at his house on a regular basis. So there's a wide influence of what's happening on so many levels in New York during that time. The vaudeville piece, as well as the animation and the relationship to film as well, you can see in the variety of his different drawings. Even to the point of, and we have a couple of drawings where they have sprockets on the side, just like a piece of film.
This is one of Goldberg's early attempts at animation. His artistic hand at work, a storyline complete with comic strip bubbles and unmistakable Goldberg humor. This is 1924. He ingeniously includes film footage of himself. Like the vaudeville comedian, he's a part of this animated stage and the butt of the joke. He created a number of cartoon strips, including Foolish Questions, Sideshow, and I'm the Guy. Those would often include sidebar panels called cartoon follies.
There's usually another cartoon, another box happening, or there's a sidebar effect of someone talking, maybe a connection, maybe something totally off. Again, this idea of having all these different things, like in vaudeville, a lot of different activities happening on one stage at the same time.
His character creations on that stage are Mike and Ike, Boob McNutt, Doc Wright, Lollapalooza, Bobo Baxter, and Rube Goldberg's alter ego, Professor Lucifer Gorgonzola Butts.
The professor image is also one out of vaudeville, just like the doctor and the nurse. And so I think he's taking some of this information from theater. He's also taking it from people's, he's soaking up what's happening in the world in general, what's on the street, what people are talking about, how people are reacting. He's a great storyteller, so he's seeing what is kind of happening and the great cultural changes that were happening at that time. We had the suffrage movement and all the cataclysmic effects that lead to ultimately two world wars and the economics that come in through that. So how people start to change about how they relate to one another. He's really this kind of interesting composite in a lot of ways of all the good and possibly some of the bad.
So as he's experiencing with the rest of the country, these phases that the country goes through, different crises that are happening, right? We talked about the Great Depression and then World War I and World War II and the development of the atomic bomb. How does he change along the way? Does his art change along the way?
His art changes. He goes from an articulated line to, which is done with a pen, to working with a brush. So the line has more of a calligraphic quality. That's sort of by the 50s, but in the 40s, he starts working with crayon. He starts doing some of the political editorial cartoons. And so you can see that those kind of shifts. He seems to have been a man, unfortunately, who I never met, but except through what the work he left, to always be questioning, looking, observing, thinking. And I don't think he had went a day without drawing. I mean, there's and then when he couldn't draw, he started sculpting. So he was someone who was on fire, I guess, in the true sense of an artist.
Well, say, who's that chap working over there?
Rube Goldberg. He's the original surrealist.
Goldberg's stardom, his Hollywood friendships, and experience writing screenplays lands him a role in the 1937 movie Artists and Models. Here, he's interviewed by Jack Benny.
I know your comic strip, Lollapalooza.
Thanks, old man. I'll do as much for you sometime.
I think he was engaged in a variety of things, and I think it depended on what was happening at the time and where that line of interest would go and how that would work with something else. If something else came in that would take his interest, I mean, he was only one person, so I mean, and there was only 24 hours in a day. And after looking at the volume of work that he accomplished, it's just amazing.
Talented and versatile, in 1938, Goldberg transitions his human interest cartoons to tackle government policy, bureaucracy, and foreign affairs. A political cartoonist with the New York Sun, he wins the Pulitzer Prize in 1948.
He was a man who was always on the move. He dabbled maybe in some things and he stayed with other things. I think he was always looking for the next idea. And I think that he was very, very aware of technological changes, and I think he wanted to be part of things. I think he wanted to see how his ideas would test in different media. And I think he was in some ways, a rather restless soul.
What made him restless?
I think he was a person who had more ideas than he had time to deal with. I think that's why, you know, when I showed you some of the sketches, he's drawing on both sides of the paper. And I think he was very excited about life and all that comes with that. And in his investigations of the different parts of life and the, you know, not only his immediate life, but also the way the world was changing. I mean, think about the amount of change that occurred from 1907 to 1967 or 1977. He got involved in so many different things, sponsorships, games. Mousetrap is based on his machines.
You mentioned the board game Mousetrap. That dates back to, I think, like the 1960s, 1970s.
I think it was 63.
So Mousetrap, video games of today.
Yeah.
I know there's a musical group out there called OK Go, and they have a number of crazy videos using Rube Goldberg concepts.
Yes, and there's also an ongoing engineering award. I think Purdue runs this, Purdue University, on an annual basis, creating or recreating Rube Goldberg contraptions.
He is co-founder and the first president of the National Cartoonist Society, formed in 1948. Its top award, presented to the Cartoonist of the Year, is the Rubin.
You are the curatorial instigator.
Correct.
Of this great exhibit. How do you hope that people remember Rube Goldberg?
I would like for people to remember him in more than just a cartoonist or a satirist or a maker of contraptions, but an artist that is in historical context, a humorist on the same level as Mark Twain and Will Rogers, as a man who kind of recorded the great changes that would have happened in the 20th century in America. I'd like for them to get to know him as a fine artist who did amazing drawings that in some ways calling him a cartoon is taking something away. And I think in this exhibition you really start to get a sense of the genius of this individual.
Clayton Michael, thank you so much.
You're very welcome.